Good morning and welcome.
And a big hello to anyone who is joining us for the first time. You are so welcome. We are Lorna and Duncan and we lead Epsom Vineyard Church. We're so glad that you have joined us today.
We're in a new Sunday series called Happy, which started last week. We're exploring how God wants his best for us and how he's interested in our happiness.
So in the weeks, we have our Alpha course starting. It starts in about a week and a half on Thursday, the 1st of October. Alpha is a great course. It's a place to ask big questions of life with some other lovely people. It's a great space to discuss and, you know, no question or answer is wrong. If you're curious about faith or new to faith, or you just love to debate and meet new people, then come and join us. You'd be really welcome. It will be run online over Zoom.
Let's just watch a quick video about that.
We are living in unprecedented times. Churches are facing incredibly difficult challenges as they learn and shift to doing church and community in a whole new way. This is a time of uncertainty, but this is also a time of opportunity. Amidst the uncertainty, people are asking questions. Who's in control? What's really important? Where's my security? Alpha is positioned to respond to these questions. We've taken Alpha online, and we are equipping the church to meet people as they search for truth. There are 4.57 billion internet users worldwide. Imagine people who are spending most of their time online, now plugged into the local church.
Alpha Online has totally astonished me. I was not interested in Alpha Online. I always said, you know, why would anyone want to do Alpha Online? This is about, you know, having a meal together. And so I had no interest in it at all. And to my amazement, it worked so well online.
We've seen thousands of people sign up to wrestle with life's biggest questions. More people are signing up now than we've ever seen in Alpha's entire history. Not only are lives being transformed, but Alpha Online is re-energizing congregations.
We have just been so thrilled to be part of Alpha Online in these last few months. And we've got over 100 guests on our course at the moment. I think we've got about 20 groups. And it's just been wonderful to see guests meeting Jesus, experiencing the Holy Spirit, and just going on their Alpha journeys in this new online format. It's been also brilliant to see the whole church here in Nottingham encouraged by the stories that are coming out of Alpha, and also the group hosts that we've been able to equip and release to lead those Alpha Online groups.
Just seen a friend dancing for ages, and we've had our conversation on opposite sides of the pavement, shouting at each other. And he said, "Oh, you're looking really well." And I said, yeah, I'm doing okay with lockdown, actually. And at the moment, I'm feeling pretty good. I said, what I've been doing, though, is I've been reading the Bible. And there's loads of stuff in it. You know, there's a lot of hope in there. And I think we're going to be all right. And there was a bit of an awkward silence. Like, they would have been with me if someone had said that to me a couple of months ago. And he said, I get you. You've become a philosopher. And I said, no, I've become a Christian. I just shouted it. It's from the other side of the pavement.
The gospel is spreading beyond church walls. We have the potential to see something extraordinary happen. Something more extraordinary than we've ever seen before.
Last week we took a moment to ask God who we could invite to Alpha, and I know some of you had already stepped out of your comfort zones and done just that. If you would like to invite someone, please feel free to do that now, or at least think about when you'd like to invite them.
So we also started another course last week. We started our CAP Money courses, and we have a number of guests joining us, which is just great. If you'd like to join our next CAP Money course, please email us cap@epsomvineyard.org.
Our midweek life groups are back up and running, so if you'd like to get involved with Epsom Vineyard, if you're kind of new, they're great places to get to know more people in our church family. Our life groups are on Wednesday and Thursday evenings, and it's where we get to kind of work out together what it really means to follow Jesus in our everyday lives.
At the end of this morning's live stream, we have a Zoom call really for people who are new to Epsom Vineyard. So if that's you and you want to say hello, do jump in on that Zoom call and say hello to some lovely people from our church. The Zoom link can be found on the Facebook and YouTube feeds on the chat function. If you don't want to do that, but you want to connect in with us and you're new, please do email us hello@epsomvineyard.org and we can arrange a virtual or a real coffee and have a chat with you.
We're going to sing to God next together. But before we sing, let's just welcome God here. Let's just pray for Alpha as well. Lord, we welcome you here this morning. We love your presence. Lord, we welcome you into our homes. We welcome you to speak to us. Holy Spirit, would you come now? Would you be present with us all as we gather over YouTube and Facebook? And Lord, we just pray for each of the people that we're inviting or that we want to invite along to Alpha. Lord, you change lives, and we're really grateful for that. And I just pray for each and every one of the people you would have us invite. Amen.
Eyes are turning to you. We turn to you. Hope is stirring. Hearts are yearning for you. We long for you. When we see you, we find strength to face the day. In your presence, all our fears are washed away, Hosanna, Hosanna, you are the God who saves us, worthy of all our praises. I hear the sound of hearts return. All things new. When we see you, we find strength to face the day. In your presence, all our fears are washed away. Washed away. Hosanna, Hosanna. You are the God who saves us. Worthy of all our.
Welcome back. Lorna started last week on our Happy series, and if you missed it, please do watch back on Facebook or YouTube. Sometimes the things we already know, when they get represented to us, they have the biggest impact. This week we've got some great tips on how to find happiness from Jesus' most famous sermon. It was really early on in his public life. He gets baptized by his cousin, goes off to the wilderness for 40 days, comes back, invites Peter, Andrew, James and John to invite to follow him from their fishing business. He starts to heal a few people and then we find a crowd assemble. And that's the moment he begins to teach. This sermon is often referred to as the Beatitudes, or at least the start of this sermon is often referred to as the Beatitudes. You probably haven't used the phrase Beatitudes all week, so I just thought I'd unpack it for you. If you are extraordinarily happy, you might describe the way you're feeling as beatitude. The root word has this idea of happiness and blessed, all pushed together. Blessed, of course, is an outward expression of knowing that we are happy. It's an adjective, I feel blessed. And yet it's also a verb. So I can't say to you, I happy you, but I can say to you, I bless you. It's something we share. So the Beatitudes carry this sense of happiness that we can pass on, or that's infectious, but it also changes our circumstances, our relationships, because it changes the atmosphere wherever we are. So if I contrast this for you, this might be helpful. We all know someone who's unhappy, and you can't come away from spending time with them without sharing their sense of unhappiness. They have this unhappy atmosphere around them. What Jesus is teaching here, by contrast to that, is what extraordinary happiness looks like. The Beatitudes, and I really just want to call them the extraordinary happinesses, are far more than all of this. As a starter, they look like keys to happiness, as in if you do X, Y, and Z, you start to get a little bit more happy. But as we delve deeper, we realize that actually they're Jesus' big selling point, they're his big announcement, his good news. They're his invitation to live differently, every day, happy. Ultimately, we're all looking to lead happy lives, but as we learn from Jesus, we can all find happiness, maybe not where we thought we needed to look for it. So we're not going to look at all the extraordinary happinesses today, but I can at least give you a taster as to a few of them. Sadly, if we think back, we've all got these. If we think back to some of the greatest regrets in our life, they often come from us knowing the difference between right and wrong, but somehow we still chose wrong. The things that we drag around with us that we wish we could erase from our minds, from our history, were probably those decisions where we knew it was the wrong choice, but we still made it. Or at least we were conflicted about that decision. It wasn't right and wrong, it was somewhere in the middle. But we still ploughed on with that decision regardless. Jesus says, I know this isn't necessarily popular in culture, but Jesus says, extraordinarily happy are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled or content or happy. So let's just flip this around. Righteousness in this context has connotations of choice and relationship. It's about living in a right relationship with God and with everyone else around us. And righteousness is about choosing right above wrong as a habit. So even when choosing right is actually the harder thing to do. Literally, Jesus is saying here what Lorna taught us last week. When you live from a place of love, you'll be happy. When you do the right things in your relationships, you'll be happy. A paraphrase of this might be, extraordinarily happy are those who live without regret, without guilt, and with a clear conscience. They will lead a full life that keeps being filled. So righteousness isn't about superiority, as in, oh, they're so self-righteous. It's about the habit of making right decisions and the habit of living in right relationships. Okay, next one. Extraordinarily happy are the merciful, because they will be shown mercy. And again, just to paraphrase this, extraordinarily happy are the relationally generous, those who show compassion and forgiveness. Happy are those who give to others what they don't deserve relationally. Happy are those who don't seek revenge, they seek forgiveness. You've probably never met a happy, bitter person, a happy person who holds a grudge. But we've all met happy people who've been really badly mistreated. They've gone through circumstances you wouldn't wish on your worst enemy. But they're happy because at some point they still decided to be relationally generous, to have the habit of forgiveness. In fact, they were probably even generous to you, even though you didn't ask for it. So a paraphrase of this might be, extraordinarily happy are those who are generous in their relationships, because they will be shown generosity. As a church over lockdown, we've taken food most weeks to our local food bank. And as a church, we donated £1,000 to them. They do a stunning job. We're so grateful for them in our borough. Also over lockdown, Lorna and I semi-regularly lent our car to a friend who otherwise wouldn't have been able to see her family, who are isolating. So both our church and us seem to have received generosity back at this time too. Epsom Vineyard, even this week, had a gift from someone who doesn't go to our church, but loves what we do. And they wanted to tithe part of an inheritance towards the ongoing work of our church family. We also had a friend messages at the start of lockdown just say that the Lord had spoken to them and they wanted to give us a gift. So what I'm not saying is that there's a direct equation between what you give and what you get, but I'm saying there's more than coincidence. We didn't give with the expectation that we would receive back, but somehow it just happened. When we live a generous life, we find ourselves at the centre of generosity. Shall I just say that again? When we live a generous life, we find ourselves at the centre of generosity. Okay, let's pause and just have a moment to reflect on some questions. Where do you give regularly to others without expecting anything back? This would be the habit of relational generosity. It could be time, could be skills, not just money or things. And can you think of a bad decision that you made that has led to your unhappiness? And if you have got one of those you can think of, what would a good decision have been? And most importantly, how can you make that into a habit today? Welcome back. For this next one, Jesus draws us in and he says, would you like to see where God is at work in the world? Would you like to recognize God's plan for your life? Would you like to make your decisions based on how God sees your situation? Even better than that, would you almost like to be able to see ahead of time, almost into the future, which decisions would lead to trouble and regret, and which decisions would lead to happiness and peace in your relationships? Jesus makes an incredible statement. Extraordinarily happy are the pure in heart, for they will see God. The Message version of this puts it slightly differently. You're extraordinarily happy when you get your inside world, your mind and your heart, put right. Then you can see God in the outside world. It's probably one of the most profound statements within the New Testament. So I've got a friend who's thinking about a major life move, but he's also sensing conflict about it. So he called me just to try and process putting his inside world straight before making this decision that genuinely affects the rest of his life. He knows that he needs to find or feel more peace about his decision. And until he gets there, my advice would be don't do it. This isn't a pure decision. So if you've got a right decision and a wrong decision, his decision is still somewhere in the middle. Let's wait till we've got a right, a pure decision. If we get this area right, not only do we get to see God, but we also save ourselves an awful lot of wasted time chasing things that really don't lead to our happiness. Jesus invites us into purity to having our thoughts and our desires aligned to his. Does that make sense? But of course, if you're in a dinner party, the idea of moral purity is probably not polite conversation. Never mind. Jesus wants all of us to know that the clarity we need in life is found in aligning our lives with his life, with his best for us. So moral and ethical purity genuinely are not bad things. Extraordinarily happy are the pure in heart because they have the best chance of identifying, seeing the activity of God on a daily basis. Now, this morning together isn't just about behaving morally. It's not just about not doing the wrong things, if that's not too many double negatives. It's about prioritizing the right things, making habits of doing them at every opportunity. It's about not compromising in the middle here, but having peace with all our decisions. One way to do this is to ask God every day for one thing that he would have you do today. Just one thing. But then, of course, make sure you do it. Let's just pause again for a few moments to ask questions of ourselves. Is there a decision you're conflicted about currently? What would it take to find peace in that decision? And you might even want to take a moment to ask God right now. Welcome back. Okay, this is our last extraordinary happiness for today. Extraordinarily happy are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. Why? Because God wants to make peace with all of us, with you, with me. And when we make peace with others, we're acting like our Heavenly Father. We're doing the things that God would do. Do you know any happy troublemakers? Any happy people who like to gossip about other people's problems? Any happy people who like to control other people? The answer is probably no. Troublemakers are often troubled by other people's happiness. They often want you to enter into their unhappiness, into their anxiety, or into their conflict. I had a really difficult conversation with someone over lockdown, someone I admire and respect genuinely. They were trying to get me to share their unhappiness about another person. It didn't take me long to work out that actually the person I was talking to and the person they were talking about were both hurting in this situation. And my role was just to be a peacemaker. But I promise you, it wasn't an easy conversation. We all know a good peacemaker. We probably all know many good peacemakers. They're also good at bringing that out in other people. Gossip can be infectious, but peacemaking infects whole teams, whole communities with happiness. I had a quick think through all the people I love spending time with, and most of them are very good at reconciling and bringing peace to relationships. Reconcilers are great to be around. I'm thinking of a friend right now who really helped me personally actually in planting this church. He always looks for the best in people. And he built his business by bringing people together. In fact, if you're listening to the whole of this morning, you're not quite sure where to start with this peacemaking thing, with this reconciling thing, I just encourage you, spend time with someone you already identify as a peacemaker, as a reconciler. They'll bring it out in you too. It's infectious. And while we're talking about that, I realize this isn't an easy practice, especially when we've been hurt personally by someone else. In preparing this morning's teaching, I was just reminded of a relational conflict I'd had with someone who was previously a good friend. I didn't ever get an apology from that person, probably never will, even though I'd apologised to them for any hurt I'd caused them in it. So when processing it earlier this week, I was at least able to ask Jesus how he sees me in that conflict and how he sees the other person too. I promise you, this is often a great first step to being a peacemaker, seeing the other person as Jesus sees them. Extraordinarily happy are the reconcilers. Extraordinarily happy are those that walk into broken relationships and bring peace and restoration. For everyone will see that they are the children of God. So with all of these beatitudes, these extraordinary happinesses, Jesus uses the analogy of farming. You sow now and you reap later. We often would prefer the analogy of a computer programmer. You update the code and everything changes forever. But Jesus says what we sow now, what we sow every year, becomes what we reap later. Our happiness is reaped over time. But how do we get to the happiness that Jesus is talking about? Is it really just that we've got a hunger for the habit of choosing the right thing, that we're relationally generous, and that we're constantly investing in reconciling broken relationships? This isn't all of it, but I promise you, these habits, these things you put into your life, will make you happier. If you're not sure what to do next, I've got two little recommendations. One, spend time with people that do these things. You'll benefit from that. And two, just avoid the things, avoid the relationships, and avoid the situations that lead you away from these good decisions, for ultimately from sowing into your happiness. Happiness is always the result of sowing, of intentionally doing the things now that are God's best for you. So if we know what God's best is for our life, and we do it intentionally, eventually that leads to lasting happiness. All right, our last questions just before we finish. What can you sow into now, today, that will reap happiness for you? And if you're used to asking God, actually please ask that question of Him right now. If you're not sure if God exists, just sit quietly. And just wait till something pops into your mind. It's often how God speaks to us. And whatever that one thing is that you want to sow into, that you feel you should be sowing into, just write it down. Welcome back. I hope you find that helpful. And we're just going to pray for each other now. As when we get together, normally when we actually get together, we like to pray for each other at the end of our gatherings. And so if you're there now and you just, either you're sensing the Holy Spirit already, or you just feel you need a little bit of prayer right now, can I just encourage you just to sit comfortably, maybe with your palms facing upwards, and just relax right now in God's presence. Lord, we just pray for your peace. Lord, we covered a lot of ground this morning quite quickly, and your extraordinary happinesses are great. And I just pray that each of us will be filled with some of that sense of your extraordinary happiness right now.
Holy Spirit, would you come? Mm. Would you invade our lives? Mm. Would you come and speak to us, and the things that you've already spoken to us as we've listened to Duncan this morning, would you kind of seal those in our lives? Would you make those real, where you've spoken to us about things we need to do or change, or would you show us the next step? Holy Spirit, would you come?
And I just get the picture of Jesus. He's talking to somebody who's made bad decisions in their life up until this point, and he's writing in the sand, and I just get the sense, that picture of we've no idea what he wrote, but of the sense of Jesus drawing a line in the sand, and he's inviting you to cross it and to leave those bad decisions behind, to leave that sense of regret, to leave that sense of whatever it is. Mm-hmm. It's not for you. Jesus's burden is light. Mm-hmm. And if we really believe that Jesus holds the key to our happiness here, can I just encourage you to step over that metaphorical line now? Step towards Jesus. And Lord, we just pray for whoever that is. Pray your peace on them. Pray your encouragement over them. Pray you just give them the overwhelming sense that you're giving them the strength to walk away from those things.
We're coming to a close now. Mm. We've just got one more song that we're going to sing together. Before that, we're just going to pray to close. God, we are so grateful for your presence. Mm. We're so grateful for your words of life. Mm. Lord, bless you and keep you. Lord, make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. Lord, turn his face towards you and give you peace. And the name of the Lord be above your household all the days of your life. Amen.
eyes above the waves. When oceans rise, my soul will rest in your embrace. For I am yours, and you are mine. Sovereign hand will be my guide. With feet prepared and fear surrounds me, you've never failed, and you won't start now. So I will call upon your eyes above the waves. When oceans rise, my soul will rest in your embrace. For I am yours, and you are mine. Whoa. My trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters, wherever you would call me. Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters, wherever you would call me. Take me deeper than my feet could ever wander, and my faith will be made stronger in the presence of my Savior. Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters, wherever you would call me. Take me deeper than my of my Savior, and I will call upon your name. Keep my eyes above the waves. When oceans rise, my soul will rest in your embrace. For I am yours, and you are mine. Borders, let me walk upon the waters, wherever you would call me. Take me deeper than my feet could ever wander, and my faith will be made stronger in the presence of my Savior.
never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop working. Keep